Audio Developers Conference is a conference that each year gathers programmers, musicians, companies, entertainers, educators, and lawyers related to audio programming. From November 13 to November 16, 2022, I took part in this conference as a speaker, supported by the company I'm working at, Loudly. From what I understood, there were 1,052 attendees, of which around 700 were present online, and around 300 attended in person. There were 93 talk submissions, out of which around half was voted in by the reviewers. The event was an incredible experience. All talks will be published on YouTube at the beginning of 2023, but to give you a short summary or a heads up on what to look out for, I have prepared a list of my personal favorites from the conference. Hi everyone, this is Jan Wilczek from thewolfsound.com, and if you're new to this channel, here you can learn how to process sound using self-written software. In this video, I will present you a list of my top picks that is completely subjective and entirely non-exhaustive. It also comes in no particular order, just so you know. If you're interested in a specific topic, you can use the YouTube chapters in the bottom bar of the screen. So, the first highlight of ADC 2022, as seen by an audio C++ developer, was a talk about eliminating undefined behavior from C++ code, in particular, an Intel processors-focused codebase. This talk was given by Russell McClellan from Isotope, which is a part of Soundwide, and was my personal favorite of all the talks, mostly thanks to its illustrative and insightful examples. If you don't know what undefined behavior or UB is in C++, it is basically everything in code that the standard or the implementations don't define. Every C++ program that contains undefined behavior is malformed. The worst part is that undefined behavior may cause trouble, but doesn't have to. What's more, it's more likely to cause trouble in a release build, but not in a debug build, which happens to be the build programmers spend most time with. Russell presented a number of options how to combat undefined behavior. Out of these, here are my favorites. Have a good compiler and pay attention to its warnings. Optionally enable treat warnings as errors. Use the clang tidy program, use address sanitizers and undefined behavior sanitizers. Ensure that your plugin does not break the plugin contract using, for example, the plugin vault tool by Traction. The CppCon 2022 version of this talk was given by Roth Michaels and can be found on YouTube. I have linked to it in the accompanying article at thewolfsound.com, which you can find linked to in the description below. Another great C++ related talk was exactly given by Roth Michaels, a colleague of Russell from Isotope. Similarly, it had also been previously given at CppCon 2022. The topic of Roth's talk was efficient pseudorandom number generation in C++ for real-time audio purposes. This assumes that we don't care about cryptographic security of the random numbers, but simply want the user to feel that some part of sound processing is random. At the same time, we have to be able to strictly control the degree of randomness for the repeatability of results and guarantee real-time safety. According to Roth, all of these requirements can be fulfilled by using the Xeroshiro 128 Plus pseudorandom number generator. This generator is real-time safe and faster than other compared approaches. Another interesting talk was given by Esa Jaaskela, who advocated for testing your digital signal processing code. I am a big believer in unit and integration testing, thus I was very happy to listen to his ideas and evangelism on this topic. For example, to test a high-pass filter, you can use a fast Fourier transform and programmatically check if the energy in the low band decreased at the output of the filter. You may go as detailed or as coarse as you wish with this, but it's already a step toward the test-driven development in audio software. Esa also showed the usefulness of the Pumplejuice template for JUCE projects, which I have been using actively since his talk. A a major announcement came from Cycling 74, which could be a real game changer in the long run. RNBO is a technology within Max that allows you to generate C++ plugin code, WebAssembly modules, or Raspberry Pi programs from Max patches. Since Max is so ubiquitous, I am curious to see if the release of RNBO results in an abundance of plugins being released that use it. I took part in the workshop on RNBO during the conference, and the generated code compiled under Windows as well. It was also great to meet one of the people behind the project, Sam Tarakajian. The only caveat of RNBO is that you need a dedicated license for it, but for people using Max, this should come as no surprise. Another great talk came from David Rowland, the CTO of Traction. He showed a complete guide to optimizing audio code on a rather high level, including everything from performance measurement to automated reporting to regression benchmarks, ones that send you an email once a performance dropped in a specific area of code. Not only did he instruct how to speed up your code, but also showed a nice way to think about benchmarking as a form of testing. If your software gets slower in benchmarks, it may mean that some unnecessary code was checked into the codebase. However, it wasn't a talk discussing low-level optimizations like loop unrolling or assembly excerpts. During ADC 22, we could learn some more details on MIDI 2.0 from the MIDI Association, Microsoft, Google, and Apple. MIDI 2.0 is slowly introduced to all major operating systems. Representatives of the MIDI associations presented the current state of the standard, and representatives of the Windows, Mac, iOS, and Android teams discussed the changes to their APIs. A great new feature of MIDI 2.0 is the MIDI device discovery, which lets you query around for available MIDI 2.0 devices you could talk to. It will still take time to implement this standard in full on all operating systems, but it's coming. For me personally, it was great to hear that the MIDI 2.0 standard is extensible, so hopefully future-proof. It was also amazing to learn how differently abled musicians closely collaborate with companies on product development. A lot in this area is done by Jason Dacent and the Sound Without Sight organization. It was of great value to me because I finally saw how accessible audio software looks in practice, so now I can take it and implement it. A very insightful talk came also from Chase Canipe on how hackers crack plugin licenses and how you could prevent it from happening to your software. I found it fascinating to see how crackers can inspect your binary code and bypass or override your license checks. An interesting talk was given by Stefano D’Angelo. He gave a nice overview of the whole audio programming business and the technologies involved. In a rather streamlined way, Stefano managed to capture the current state of digital signal processing engineering industry and the challenges the DSP engineers must face. Interestingly, to help push things in the right direction, he proposed a code library with digital signal processing building blocks called Brickworks. A major announcement came from SoundStacks, which is a part of Soundwide, the C major language for audio-specific software. One of the creators of this language is Julian Storer, the creator of the JUCE framework. C major is a new language specifically for audio DSP. Its main features are easy installation in Visual Studio Code, just-in-time compilation or hot reload of code inside the running plugin, which should speed up the development immensely. Allegedly, a very good performance. I don't know, I haven't tested it yet. And a possibility to include a web interface and transpiling the code from Cmajor to a JUCE C++ framework project. These points make the language very exciting, but the question remains on how this technology will develop. Call me skeptical, but I simply hate libraries or frameworks or languages turning deprecated. What's your opinion on this? Have you tried out this language already? let me know in the comments below. Attendees of ADC 2022 could also see and listen to incredible voice transfer demos of the Supertone company. Their software allows you to imitate someone's voice from just a few dozen seconds of recording or even change entire spoken sequences in post-production. Since it's an Asia-based company, it's kind of hard to find something about them in the English language side of the internet. You need to wait for ADC 22 videos to go live at the beginning of 2023 to find out more about the project. I also finally managed to learn more about the Elk Audio operating system. This technology by Elk Audio allows you to control remote audio software in real time, for example running on an embedded device, without a loss in performance. You are able to control the parameters of your embedded plugin, for example, with an automatically generated remote graphical user interface. I took part in Elk's workshop during the conference, and I must admit that Elk Audio OS is a very handy approach to developing embedded or headless audio software. After consulting projects in the area of embedded software, I know what a pain is the lack of remote control, like a terminal or a GUI. Additionally, the Elk Audio team is awesome. Another technology I found interesting at ADC was Newton by Cosmo. It is a technology that allowing you to rather easily deploy trained neural networks in audio plugins. It allows you to transfer your PyTorch neural network model to run inside a real-time audio plugin. Unfortunately, it's Mac only for now. I am looking forward to a Windows version of this software that allows researchers quickly validate their models on live audio. It was also great to talk to Andrew Fife and Christopher Mitcheltree, who actively developed the software. The last talk that I would like to mention here is my talk. And not because of its quality, because that's not for me to judge, but because I was honored and surprised, to be honest, to be able to speak at the Audio Developers Conference 2022. The goal of my talk was to show that deep learning in audio is not reserved for universities or research departments of some big audio company. On the contrary, the resources and tools to start with deep learning in audio are readily available online for free right now. I tried to present a step-by-step approach that you can take to learn deep learning even when you've never done anything similar before. The talk went well, even the live coding part. I was happy to receive positive feedback after the talk, which resulted in a few interesting conversations. However, I would also like to hear some criticism. That may happen after the video recording of my talk gets published on YouTube. Until then, the slides and the code are available on GitHub. The link can also be found in the link to article on thewolfsound.com, which is in the description below. The conference was nice and all, but there is one thing that was my biggest personal highlight, and it will stay in my memory for sure. It was you. Thanks to all of you who walked up to me and said hi or thank you for your tutorials. I really, really appreciate every gesture like this, and I hope to continue to serve you in the field of audio programming education in 2023 to the best of my abilities. Speaking of which, if you haven't yet retrieved my free audio plugin developer checklist, you can do so at thewolfsound.com/checklist. It will show you which bits and pieces of knowledge are needed to maybe attend Audio Developers Conference one day. Thanks a lot to the organizers, the sponsors, and the attendees of the Audio Developers Conference 2022. I hope to see everyone there next year. But for now, thanks for watching and take care. Oh, and by the way, did you know that you can actually subscribe to the channel